Hello everyone. My name's Patricia Davidson and I have the honour and privilege of being the Dean of the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing. Although I can't be with you here today in Turkey, I am delighted to record my comments and wish you all the very best for this very important Congress. The title of my talk today is From the Hospital on the Hill to the Community and the Role of Nurses in Home Care. And I hope this talk helps to set some key concepts for you to deliberate and discuss over the next few days in this very important Congress. So what I'd like to achieve over the next half an hour or so is to look at epidemiological transitions and ask you to consider the implications for healthcare. In particular, I would like to focus on the role of social determinants of health in moderating health outcomes. And I'd like to then finish my talk by summarising the implication for the role of nurses in community-based healthcare. One way of encapsulating what's happening in our modern world is demonstrated by this quote from Dr. Kaufman. She says that our ancient genes and modern worlds have collided. So we celebrate many healthcare advances, in particular, decrease of maternal mortality, decrease in the impact of infectious diseases. But what the world now faces is increasing numbers of people living with chronic and complex conditions. So this shifts our focus in terms of nursing and healthcare from an acute episodic focus to looking at healthcare more across the lifespan, focusing both on prevention of illness and disease, the management of illness and disease, and importantly, for the increasing number of elderly people living with chronic and complex conditions, palliation of advanced diseases. I love this slide, mainly because it provides a celebration of what we've really achieved in healthcare. And in particular, when I look at this slide, I take great comfort from the fact that 60 is the new 40. But what this slide also demonstrates in a very salient way is this slide is from Australia, but in most developed countries now, one in three children born today will live to be 100. That's pretty amazing, and it also changes the focus of healthcare. For example, when I started working in cardiology, we actually thought that someone 60 years of age coming to the coronary care unit was old. But as we know now, we have increasing numbers of people in their 80s and 90s, in not just in the hospital, but in critical care areas. And in some areas of the world, centenarians are the fastest growing segment of the population. So considering the context of health outcomes, and we know that we celebrate the aging of the population, but unfortunately, this increased longevity is not necessarily accompanied by good health and prosperity. And across the world, we're increasingly looking at the intersection of health and social care. And we are thinking more about how social determinants of health apply to not just predicting health outcomes, but also moderating health outcomes once some people have an illness or disease. So we talk about social determinants of health, and this defines the conditions in which people are born, grow, work, live, and age, and the wider set of forces and systems shaping the conditions of daily life. And this covers a wide range of factors, including economic policies, healthcare systems, social norms, political systems, and also the environment around us. And I know here in Turkey, just minutes from where you're having this conference, you are experiencing the trauma of many refugees from Syria and trying within your country to accommodate this increasing growing population who need health and assistance. And I congratulate you for your humanitarian response in this area. So this is just a laundry list of what are some of the factors that we call social determinants of health that impact on health outcomes? And as you can see, these range from income inequality through to the food environment, transportation, and housing. And as you think about nursing going from the hospital to the home and the community environment, failing to think of these critical factors will mean that you are not going to be configuring, developing optimal models of care, and also will not be able to adequately address the needs of people who you seek to serve. So one lesson that I've learned over my nursing career is that the predictors of outcomes across life really are predefined before children are born. And so this again makes us think about, if we're really wanting to moderate health outcomes, providing a healthy start to children, not just about saying we're saving more babies' lives and the global rates of infant mortality are decreasing, but that we're actually moderating on health outcomes. And so really thinking about models of care, strategies to support families are important considerations. And later in this talk, I'll give you an example of an activity that we're doing here at Johns Hopkins to really address the life course approach to disease. The other factor that we are challenged with in terms of contemporary healthcare, and a factor which is really leveraging much of the pressure for home-based care and community-based care, is what is being coined the triple aim. You know, how do we achieve improved quality, decrease cost, and increase access? And more, how we configure each of these dimensions to what we call a value-based agenda. And we know from countries around the world, particularly the United States, which spends 80% of its gross domestic product on healthcare, just spending money, just increasing technological access, does not equate with improvements in quality of life or longevity. So increasingly, as nurses and healthcare professionals, we have to think of the configuration of each of these factors. And this is a conceptual framework that helps us think about how we can act on the social determinants of health. And so we need to think about not just the clinical context, but what is more broadly the social and economic and political context in which we practice. And we have to think of just not individual patient level factors, but the communities they live and also the society in which they live. And again, this framework just really emphasizes this fact that we need to be thinking about healthcare within a broader context. And many of you will be familiar with the term a social ecological framework. And increasingly, that's what we're thinking about healthcare, not just as individual foci of care, but healthcare within an ecosystem. And this ecosystem is complex, but what we cannot deny is that each of these factors has a reciprocal and interrelated impact on each of the other factors. So if we think about just as a nurse going to the home, replicating the models of acute care that we've provided in hospitals without thinking about the broader social, economic, and political context, we are not going to get the best outcomes for our patients and their families. So with the preceding few slides, I've made some comments that I think are really important for you to consider within the context of this conference. Firstly, we need to celebrate the successes in healthcare. We need to celebrate the fact that having a myocardial infarction for a man in their 40s does not mean imminent death. And we need to celebrate that many cancers, particularly breast cancer for women, is now another chronic condition. So basically, the number of people that we are going to care for is growing. The complexity of their care is growing. And so that means, as nurses and midwives, we have to think about how we develop nurses for practice, what are our practice models, and how we can best integrate within this healthcare ecosystem to improve outcomes for patients and their families. So now I'm going to bring you back a little bit more to the title of my talk. So when I started nursing, as many of you probably in this room, very similarly, the focus was all about the hospital. And commonly, you just go around many cities and the hospital is on the hill, and it's kind of situated where people are come to the hospital. And when we think about that, commonly people come to hospitals for acute care illness. But we know for many of the chronic illnesses that we've talked about, both malignant and non-malignant diseases, we need a complex life course approach to management of those conditions. So why now is the focus on community and home-based healthcare an important consideration? Well, as nurses, we'd like to think that's because people want to be at home and home is the best place to provide care. And that is probably very right. Most people do not want to be in the hospital alone. They want to be at home with their families. But what is the big agenda that is forcing us to really think thoughtfully and intentionally about home and community-based models is how we accommodate this burgeoning costs associated with chronic illness care. On the slide in front of you, these are data from Kaiser Permanente in the United States, but these same cost models have been emulated in many countries of the world, including the United Kingdom and Australia. And what this slide shows is that 6% of the population consumes 33% of the healthcare budget. And that segment of the population are those people living with multiple chronic illnesses. Now, we would know that if this expenditure was associated with great health outcomes, maybe this could be justified. But many of you who work in clinical areas know that admission to the hospital for an exacerbation of heart failure or COPD or renal failure is not really reflected in people feeling better. And we know in many clinical entities, in particular heart failure, which is my area of expertise, hospitalization is not associated with improvement in quality of life or symptoms. So this has really caused a shift in how we think about care, because a lot of the costs associated with hospitals are, when we look at the data analytically, much of the money that is spent is waste, particularly through ordering of unnecessary tests, duplications of assessments, people operating within a paradigm when they're not thinking thoughtfully and intentionally about the tests they order. And also, we know, particularly for older people, hospitals are dangerous places. You would have seen in the British Medical Journal just 2 months ago a study that came from authors at Johns Hopkins, which demonstrated that adverse events or patient safety failures are the third leading cause of death in the United States. So as you can see, there are many compelling arguments to shift care from the hospital to the community. And this is just, again, an example of what an acute hospital means. This is Johns Hopkins in Baltimore, again, a beacon in the city. From my apartment, I can look up the hill and can see Johns Hopkins. But even in this stellar medical center, there is much more increasingly an emphasis on home and community-based care. And within the context of healthcare reform in the United States, Johns Hopkins is part of an accountable care organization, which is looking to provide healthcare to a population, not just to specific individuals. And in many countries across the world, people are shifting reimbursement for healthcare from fee-for-service and individual patients to metrics that evaluate the quality of health of a population. So as nurses, we need to be more nimble in this environment to understand these factors, not just for the clinical management, but how we think about healthcare on a population basis. So this is a model from Ed Wagner that has really shaped a lot of my work over the last 20 years or so. Ed Wagner developed this model in the United States, and this model generated a huge amount of work in chronic illness. And the success of this model meant that it was actually adopted by the World Health Organization. And so I'm just going to step you through some of the important elements of the model. Firstly, you will know people rhetorically speak about person-centered care, family-centered care. I'm sure in every hospital that you work in and you go to visit your family members in, this is provided as a goal of care. But for those of us who have both been in the system as healthcare workers and as patients, know that commonly we fail to meet the needs of patients and families. So the chronic care model, how it was generated, was an intense literature review process where elements that contributed to individual studies to improve outcomes with chronic illness were combined in within this conceptual model. And as you can see, overarching this whole model is the positive policy environment. That means that we are never going to really affect change at the level of the patient, community, or population unless we have positive environments that promote interface between healthcare settings, educational institutions and professional groups that provide leadership and advocacy, and important policies that are going to drive clinical improvements. And as you can see, one of the key links in this model is the link between the community and the healthcare organisation. So we need to work with communities to reduce stigma for disease, to encourage greater participation in healthcare, we need to promote health literacy, and we need to promote engagement within a healthcare agenda. I'm not just going to give you an example from heart failure, which demonstrates the importance of integrating clinical science, expertise, research evidence, and policy. So chronic heart failure is the terminal phase of many cardiovascular disease conditions. And what we know from multiple randomized controlled trials is that nurse-coordinated interventions that focus on adherence with evidence-based recommendations, promoting self-management, and also care and coordination can improve health outcomes. So there have been many meta-analyses, but I'm just going to give you an example today of this meta-analysis from McAllister, which pooled data from many heart failure studies. So as you can see here in these graphs, that for all-cause mortality is decreased by 20% for this model of intervention. And we know that all-cause admission for heart failure was decreased by 30% and all-cause readmission by 28%. Now, you can imagine if this was a new drug, people would be running to the stock markets to invest in this model of intervention. So what this meta-analysis shows, this a pooling of individual high-quality randomized controlled trials, that there is robust evidence. But the next part of the story that I wanted to tell you was a sequel to this meta-analysis. This was a study done by Sao and colleagues, and they went back to those 30 randomized controls of multidisciplinary heart failure management that were in the McAllister meta-analyses. They emailed the first authors of each of those studies. And in spite of the robust evidence, what they found was that 13 of the 15 studies in the United States did not continue into usual care. And 7 of the 13 did not continue or expand. So what in other countries? So what this tells us that we have to think about incentivizing what makes good healthcare. Why many of the 13 of the 15 studies didn't continue in the United States is that many hospitals were actually making money from people being readmitted to the hospital. There was not an incentive to keep people out of the hospital. But now within the context of the Affordable Care Act and hospitals actually being penalised for people that are readmitted within 30 days, there is this wide embracing of this model of intervention. So what I've wanted to really illustrate from this example is that it's just not good enough to do research. We need to really engage the policy environment to influence and change practice. The other point that I really wanted to make was in terms of social determinants of health. Get us back to start thinking about the whole importance of the life course. So many people think, well, look, if we can just promote universal healthcare coverage and people can have access to healthcare, all of these disparities will go away. But that's not the case. And so when you're working in home and community-based settings, you have to be really aware of this. So this is really a magazine that I picked up several years ago. And of course, I'm in cardiovascular. I thought, heart healthy holidays. What would be some of the important lessons to that? So it said, you know, planning an Easter break, take care. Researchers say holidaying in unfamiliar places can bring new challenges that may trigger a heart attack. So I sort of thought, well, this is really interesting. And as you can see, just the facts that they said, heart attacks are more than twice as likely to occur among people who travel by car than plane than other forms of transportation. And also heart attacks are nearly 10 times more likely among those who stay in a tent or mobile home rather than a hotel. Well, I know here today at the Divan Hotel, you will be incredibly safe because it's such a beautiful hotel. But what this message is, and many of you who are faculty in this room, is an important lesson where you tell students, particularly in the public health domain, that association doesn't mean causation. So clearly here, the fact that if you get on a plane and stay in a hotel means that you're richer. So again, I just wanted to provide an example of my own research, which has demonstrated that even in a context of universal healthcare coverage, there is still health disparities in outcomes. So these are data from Australia, and I know it's a complex slide, but also I'll work you through it. So just down on this axis are the local government areas, and these are standardized mortality rates. If we just go to here and have a little look around, we know that within the city areas, the metropolitan areas, the mortality rate is lower. And then if we go to the top, particularly where we're looking at rural areas, we can see that mortality is higher. And then I can tell you in these two local government areas where I worked, where there was the greatest proportion of Aboriginal Australians, you can see that the standardized mortality rates are higher. So why I want to talk to you about this, it's just not good enough to have a policy that says we should have universal healthcare, that access is important, is that sometimes we need tailored and targeted strategies. And this is increasingly recognized around the world. And I really recommend this paper to you. And Dr. Cheryl Dennison Himmelfarb, who's one of the authors, is a professor in the School of Nursing at Johns Hopkins. But what the United States faces as being this sort of hub of technological and innovation and really driving a lot of the science in improving outcomes for the management of cardiovascular disease. For the first time, there is the potential that children of the next generation will not live as long as their parents. And we know the reasons for this is the increasing burden of diabetes, increasing rates of obesity. And so the American Heart Association has put out a policy statement on the social determinants of risk and outcomes for cardiovascular disease, which is a huge advancement. Because I remember when I started in cardiology, people thought, yeah, maybe the social did make a difference. But we now know that the biggest predictors of adverse outcome are living alone and marginalization and alienation. So these are important factors to consider. So we know from all of the data that we look at that poverty, access to care, racism, and environmental exposure lead to adverse outcomes. Yet in so many conditions, we are looking, you know, for the magic gene, the magic cure. But most of our healthcare reform is going to occur in terms of addressing the social determinants of health. And this is where nurses are ready for prime time. And this is why the discussion and debate at your conference about aged care, home care, and the increasing role of community-based care is increasingly important in driving a new agenda. So now I'm just going to bring you back to Baltimore, to the environment of Johns Hopkins, and just get you to think about some of the factors that people are trying to work at in our local environment. Baltimore is like many big steel cities, cities in the United States, and because of changes in industry, have been really subject to a lot of social and transformational change. And what this study was undertaken by colleagues in the School of Public Health was basically found that it's much easier to get cigarettes than it is food. And so, in fact, the streets around Johns Hopkins are commonly described as food deserts. And so there's a lot of community advocacy and activities to increase access to fresh food. And so one wouldn't think in a country as prosperous as the United States this would be an issue. And now we know that also there's increasing data that shows that just being overweight doesn't mean that you're actually well nourished. And so you can be, you know, be overweight and obese and actually not be well nourished. And this is an important consideration for us to think about. And also, I told you I would come full circle and talk to you about the life course approach to disease. And I just really wanted to provide an example of an activity that we're undertaking at Johns Hopkins. Just three or four blocks away from the Johns Hopkins campus, the hospital on the hill, the picture that I showed you earlier in the slide, we have a very exciting, innovative school. It's the Henderson Hopkins School, which is an initiative between the local city, Johns Hopkins, and to improve care and education for young children in East Baltimore. Here within this school, the School of Nursing runs the healthcare suite and are really trying to engage in healthcare programs that are going to improve children's well-being, not at school, just at school, but set them on a good life course approach to well-being. And just here in this slide, I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Phyllis Sharps, who some of you may have met, who is coordinating our programs in the community. So Johns Hopkins realizes that we just cannot provide acute-based care on the hill. We need to reach out to our communities if we really want to make a difference to population health. So Johns Hopkins' involvement in the Henderson Hopkins School is, we hope, will be a model to transform thinking about how nurses interact within the community, and shifting the school-based health nurse model from just purely, you know, putting band-aids on and caring for children who have a headache, to really thinking about how we intervene in health programs to make sure that children have a healthy start to life. So, as I mentioned, it's just not enough to have good healthcare policy. We have to think about tailored and targeted approaches to specific communities, because just providing health information is not sufficient to engage behaviour change. And it's not also sufficient to get people to change their behaviours. So I also like to get you to consider this slide, which really gets us to think about how we address social determinants of health and to provide a pathway to equity. So as you can see in this slide, this is disparity, but just giving everybody the same amount or in the same way is going to maybe provide what we might say equal access. But to really move to equity in vulnerable populations, we need specific and targeted strategies to ensure that they have improved access to healthcare. So, in finalising my talk, I just want you to join a few pieces together. This is a model from the Lancet Global Health Initiative, which has sort of forecasted what it's going to take to improve healthcare as we look to the future. And they think about healthcare within three specific domains. Firstly, the high rates of avertable infectious child and maternal deaths. And we know that we have made amazing gains in that space. We particularly, you know, examples of HIV decreasing maternal deaths is a wonderful example if collaboration across the world and in particular support from philanthropy and a unified policy agenda can make a difference. And even though this work is not done, we're still on the way to getting those goals. So what is happening in this emerging agenda? the place that we are really currently in. We've seen this huge demographic change and has shifted the global burden of disease from infectious diseases to non-communicable diseases, and also the impact of the environment and injuries on healthcare. Just this week, we have seen across the globe many sad issues, from the turmoil and conflict in Syria to random shootings in the United States. We really have to look much more critically at some of these issues. And we know that rates of suicides in many countries and the burden of mental health is increasingly of a concern. And then also what we have to realise, that just throwing money at the problem is not going to make it go away. We have to have evidence-based models. We need to work to a value-based agenda, and how we achieve both equity and equality are going to be important conversations for the next century. And this slide just demonstrates some of my comments, that just by, if you can see, particularly in some countries such as the United States, which spend a much higher amount on healthcare than any other countries, is not necessarily associated with effective healthcare and safe care. So this is a fundamental call to action for us to shift our focus on care that we have developed probably since the days of Florence Nightingale to be appropriate to acute care, very critically focused models of care, to a much more strategic approach to health management across the lifespan, and also in particular looking at the burden of chronic illness. So how are we going to achieve these health outcomes? Well, I've talked about the importance of policy, and this policy needs to be informed by research. And again, we, particularly for many of you who are faculty in this room, how do we prepare nurses and other health professionals to work in this dynamic and innovative space? This calls us to really think about our curriculum, which are mainly still focused very much on hospital-based care, to increase the emphasis on community-based care. We need to look in our curricula to increase the content on information on behaviour change, providing students with skills in motivational interviewing, having crucial conversations, being able to assess and manage health at the level of the population, not just the individual, are important factors. And of course, it's really the culmination of all of these factors which is going to improve the quality of practice, the value of healthcare, and also hopefully the health and well-being of individuals and populations. So, in conclusion, it's been a pleasure to be able to have this recording with you, and again, my apologies for not being there in person. But I hope over the next few days you'll take some of the overarching concepts that I've provided and think of those within the context of the talks that you'll be having. So the focus of and delivery of healthcare is changing. Some people might not be happy, comfortable, satisfied with that change, but as I hope I've convinced you, the data is compelling. We cannot just keep doing things the same way we have been. Increasingly, as nurses, as advocates for patients, we have to be very mindful that health and well-being is moderated by the environment, influenced by social, political, and economic factors, and there are clear social gradients in health. Sadly, poorer people live shorter lives with greater disability than more affluent citizens. Health equity, human rights, and the distribution of power should not just be in the vocabulary and the nomenclature of social science. This is a core dimension of what nursing is and should be. And nurses moving from the hospital to the home and the community has not just the potential to improve health outcomes at the individual, it also has potential to improve health outcomes at the level of communities and societies. So again, thank you so much for allowing me to be here with you today. I really hope you enjoy the rest of the conference in beautiful Istanbul. I hope you take the opportunity to celebrate nursing. I'd also like to take this opportunity to recognise the vision and investment of Mrs. Arcel in nursing in Turkey. Your vision, your philanthropy has really not just shaped the world here at Koç University, but has the potential to really improve healthcare outcomes in Turkey and the region and beyond. So I really hope you enjoy the rest of the meeting and hope to see you again soon in Istanbul, or please come visit us again here at Johns Hopkins in Baltimore. Thank you very much.